Paxos is a really fundamental algorithm in distributed systems. It was invented over a decade ago by Leslie Lamport, who is very famous, won the Turing Award, which is like the computer science equivalent to the Nobel Prize, and he's had tons of contributions. And this is really one of the most important ones that he did during his time doing research. It's for getting computers who can talk to each other to agree on something. So computers, just like your computer at home, they sometimes fail, sometimes the network gets cut off, and yet we still need to have a reliable system over that. So for example, with your bank, if you transferred money from one person to another, and then the money kind of went out your account but never arrived at the other account because a computer somewhere had failed, you wouldn't be very happy about it. So we need to be able to reliably reach agreement between machines, even though they're silly and they fail and they break and networks fail. Paxos has two kind of main phases, and the key thing to Paxos is in each of these phases, you have to have the majority of nodes coming to an agreement before we can move on. So that means in a system of five nodes, you need three nodes to be in agreement before we can move on.
So it's democracy, right?
Yeah, absolutely. And it's super useful because it means that if some of the nodes are down, you just carry on without them. And that's absolutely fine. When they come back up, if they come back up, we can help them along and tell them about what happened. Say you're a client, for example, you're a person who wants to get a lock, and it's super important in the system that only one person can ever get this lock. We might have a system here of five nodes, and we might have a client over here. Let's call her Alice. And she wishes to procure some super useful lock, and we have to make sure that only one person can ever have this lock. So she asks her nearest node, hey, can you get hold of this lock for me? In this system, we have five nodes, and so we need three of them at each stage to agree before we can move on. And there are two main stages. There's the promise stage and there's the commit stage. The node's gonna generate a unique ID. We'll say their ID is 13. And they're gonna contact every other node and say, hey guys, I wanna make some progress on this. Will you agree to let me do that? And they say, yep, that's absolutely fine. And they remember that they've agreed. So I'll call it P for promise. So they all remember that they promised that 13 would be the node that's in charge and getting stuff done. Okay, and they're all happily, no failures at the moment, they're all happily agreed, and so we can move on to the next stage. In the next stage, node 3, on behalf of Alice, is gonna contact everybody and say, hey everybody, can you commit ID 13, the fact that, let's say, Alice is the person who's gonna have the lock. And all of these guys remember that it's Alice, I'll just write a little A for each of them who has it, and they also remember that it was 13, which is the ID. And they all respond and say, okay. And now node 3 can say, Alice, there you go, you have the lock, you can go on, do what it was you want to do, and regardless of what happens in this system in terms of failures, we'll never give anybody else that lock, okay? That's entirely yours. So
just give an example of this lock is maybe access to her account, or if it were banking or something like that?
Yeah, it could be access to an account. It could be, for example, the ability to write to a file. So often in code, we have regions of code where we want to ensure that only one person is ever executing that. So maybe they're editing a file and you don't want multiple people trying to do this. And the other thing is, like with a bank account, you might want to kind of have the lock. You know, I'm the only person who can change this amount right now. And then when you're finished, give that up. Locks are super useful and they're really kind of widely used abstraction. So a simple thing like this can then be used loads within systems. So, you know, here Alice is a person, but often Alice would be, you know, a device operating on behalf of a person. Let's have a look at what happens if one of these machines was to fail, for example. Actually, let's make it worse. Let's make two machines fail. So here comes Alice. She wants to procure this lock. She talks to node 5 this time and says, hey, can you get this lock for me? So node 5 is gonna send out a message to everyone saying, say their ID is 15. Will you promise to let me in with ID 15? These guys will respond and it will respond to itself, saying, that's okay, you can go ahead with that. And they'll remember that they promised 15. Now, this is a system of five nodes, and as I said, we need a majority, and we have a majority here because we've got node 1, node 4, and node 5. That's three nodes. So despite the fact these two nodes are completely offline, that's fine, we can carry on.
Five can then send out a message to everyone again saying, can you commit the fact that 15, and it's going to be Alice. And then all of these guys will remember it's Alice who got the lock with ID 15. Now, in the future, these nodes might come back up. Hopefully, you know, you've sent for an engineer and they've come fix the problem for you. And nodes 2 and 3 that have recovered don't know anything about what's gone on. So maybe someone else comes along, says to 2, hey, I'm Bob, and I would like that lock, please. Node 2 is gonna send a message to everyone saying, I would like to be in charge for 12. And each of these from before have remembered that the last person that they promised to had ID 15. Once you've made a promise, you can only break your promise to someone with a higher ID than the ID that you promised to. So these numbers go up and up over time. So in this case, 12 is smaller than 15. So these guys are gonna say no. Actually, 3 will say yes because they don't know what's going on with the system beforehand. So they'll say 12 and everyone else is gonna say no. So in this case, number 2 is gonna have another go, try again. And they're gonna generate a new ID. And they're gonna make sure that their ID is bigger than any of the IDs that they saw earlier. So say it's gonna be 22 now. I'll try again. And I'll say to everyone, hey, with 22, can I be in charge of what's going on? And 22 is higher than 15. So they're actually all gonna come back and say, yeah, that's okay. But the really important stage here is that if they have committed a value before, when they say okay, they'll include what the value was. So in this case, it was nodes 1, 4, and 3. And when they say okay, they will also say that previously it was agreed that Alice had the lock with ID 15. And so that will be this guy, and this guy will all say that.
So is Alice stuffed at this point? Is she stuffed?
No, not quite yet.
She will be though.
Well, it's Bob that's got the problem here, okay. Because it's Bob that won't be able to get this. So okay. Even though 2 was trying to operate on Bob's behalf and get this lock, Bob, the 2 has just found out that actually Alice had already been agreed. And so what 2 will do is instead of sending out a commit for Bob, 2's actually going to send out a commit for Alice to everybody and say commit with its number, which was 22, Alice.
Okay, you throw me there.
So the idea of Paxos is that in the end, everyone needs to find out about what happened. So in this example, 2 and 5 weren't aware of what had happened. And as a side effect of 2 trying to do something which was conflicting, 2's actually found out about what happened and they've told everybody. So 5, after they recovered, didn't have a clue what was going on. And now they know actually it was Alice that has got the lock. So by going through that extra stage before you commit anything, we ensured that Bob couldn't have got that lock.
So the thing about having the higher ID was just him trying it on, was it? Or If it hadn't have been committed, if it had just been promised, would he have got the lock then? Because he's got a higher ID, or is that?
If it had just been promised, he would have been able to, yeah. So what you basically do is once you get a promise from everybody, if nobody has told you that anything's been committed, you're free to choose whatever value you want to commit. However, if things have gone wrong, for example, maybe the node that was actually trying to do the commit might have failed midway through, you might end up getting one person telling you Alice had it, another person saying Bob had it, another person saying Charlie had it. And the importance of the IDs here is that whoever has the highest ID with it, that's the one that you then disseminate to everybody and say, Charlie is the man who has the lock. Let's have a look at what a failure midway through might actually look like. This is node 3, and we've got our friend Alice still trying to get her lock in the system. So as before, node 3 is gonna ask everyone to promise with their ID, which will say 13, and everyone will remember that they promised 13 and respond to say it was okay. And then 3 might message these guys and say commit for Alice in 13, and then node 3 might fail. We have to work out, what do we do? Did Alice ever get that lock? Did Alice not get that lock? So the message was sent to nodes 1 and 2 before 3 failed. So these guys are going to agree and send back. But these messages won't matter because 3 has unfortunately failed.
So we have to kind of look at this and work out what to do about this. So in the future, someone else might come along and try to get this lock. And if, say, this is 4 trying to do this, when they're going to send out their promise and they're going to try and send out their commit, and when they do this, they're going to find out that people have already committed Alice, and therefore they won't give it away again. Instead, they'll just tell everybody that it was Alice who was successful.
Would there be a majority there, though, if there are 4 nodes and 2 of them?
The interesting thing about majorities is if you have, say, a set of 5 nodes and you need 3 for a majority, any majorities will always overlap. So if you ask and you get a majority and just one of them says this thing happened, that there could be a majority that exists where that happened. So just one person saying something happened is enough.
I see. Because it's committed, it must have been a majority at some point.
Yeah, absolutely.
I got you. Okay. And then does Alice ever find out about that if 3 has died?
So Paxos itself is just kind of a really kind of basic idea, and you build systems on top of it. So it's up to the system. Usually what would happen in this scenario is Alice would try asking someone else, can you do this for me, and find out that it was successful.
So basically this is you might implement it in various ways, is that what we're saying?
Yeah, absolutely. And the big thing as well is this is just agreement over a single value. But in practice, we want to reach agreement over many values. We want the value to change over time. You know, you want Alice to be able to get the lock and then return the lock. And because of that, what we use is something called multi-Paxos, which is like this, but multiple times, basically. And the really interesting insight here is that this took 2 stages, 2 kind of round trip times across the network. But the first stage, when we were sending out these promise messages, it didn't matter that it was Alice or Bob, it didn't matter what was going on. So what we can do is we can do this first stage before any requests are even there. And by doing that, when Alice comes along, if the node's already done the first stage, it's just 1 round trip time.
Basically, they're putting in a bit of groundwork before anyone even asks. So if I had a user here and they wanted something, would you be all right with that?
Yeah, basically. So when we did this for the first time, there was no kind of thing that said it was Alice when we did that first round. So they can basically do that in advance before they even know. And then when someone comes along and asks for it, then they can get it. But the restriction there would be, at the moment, Alice could ask anybody and they could do it, and it would take 2 kind of phases or 2 round trip times. If 3 kind of did the preparation work first, then Alice would only be able to go to 3. But if they did go to 3, then it would just take 1 round trip time. When we do this bit of work, we call this kind of electing a leader. So you're basically saying to one machine, you're in charge. So you can, in pretty much any setting, you can say, you're going to be the leader, you're going to be in charge. And that could be one of the people, one of their machines, one of the servers in the cloud. And then you send all the requests to that one, and then they distribute it like this.
What is probably one of the most common places this is used?
I would actually say this example is probably a really good example of where it's used. So in big distributed systems, it's really important to have this idea of locks. So this idea that only one person can be doing certain things at a time. We like to think that systems are really parallel and we have lots of things going on at once, but at some point, usually we need to say actually only one person is allowed to edit that file at that time. Only one person is allowed the permission to access this key at that time. So locks in a distributed system is a really good example of where you might need something like this.
The problem is that any of these connections, if these are all using HTTP, then there's no way for the browser to verify that the data that's coming back here